so nice and quiet, we'll start. So good evening. We are 1 week before Rosh Hashanah. When you hear the word Rosh Hashanah, you get goosebumps, you get nervous. Some people get depressed, sad, nervous. All kinds of symptoms when Rosh Hashanah comes. Some people, Rosh Hashanah for them, it's a picnic day. You know, not everyone lives in Muncie or Chestnut Ridge or Borough Park that they feel it. Some places in Eretz Israel, thousands of people go barbecue, have no idea what they live for. Nothing. You ask them what's the purpose of life, what do you do here, they're not even aware they have a neshama. Millions of people don't believe they have a neshama. That's how bad the situation is. But the 20% of the Jewish world, from 13.2 million people, approximately this is 2 million who keeps the mitzvot. Of course, no one is perfect, some more, some less, but at least they're aware of what needs to be done. Whether they do it or not, it's another story. And we are, like I say, we are now 1 week before. And today I want to take a different approach than my usual lectures. Usually, most of my lectures is a strong musar and a wake-up call. And sometimes I help people to become more nervous, which is good, because people have to feel nervous before the judgment day. I don't know if you ever heard that one time Rav Shach, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, spoke in Ponovich, Yeshiva, and he banged on the table, hundreds of people there. And he said, what's the difference between a Jew to a monster? So he gave an example of Eichmann, Adolf Eichmann, Yimach Shimo, that a few hours before they burned it, they hung him and burned him, they asked him, what is your last request? So a person that you're going to, knows in 1-2 hours they're going to hang him, he asked for a steak, a good glass of wine, dry red wine, and a German newspaper. The worst three things that a person should ask for, he asked for, just to show you what kind of monster he was. That 1 or 2 hours before they're going to hang him, he has the patience now to sit and eat the steak like business as usual. No regret, no fear, no where am I going to. This is how low a person can be. But a Jew, 1 month before the judgment day, in the previous generation, in Eretz Israel, when the Gabbai came to the shul and he say, it was Rosh Chodesh Elul, so he say, ladies and gentlemen, Elul, half of the people in the shul were fainting. Only one generation ago. It's not a joke. It's not an exaggeration. In the places, in the good neighborhood of Yerushalayim, in Bnei Brak, they bang on the table, see people falling on the chairs from the fear of the judgment day. There's two kinds of approach how to prepare to Yom HaDin. Some people focus on their negative and encourage them to cure the situation, to do tshuva, to correct as much as they can, which is very necessary. Most of the time, people are, when Yom HaDin comes, they're beginning to remember all the negative and all the problems they did in a previous year. But there's another way. The other way is that people have to focus on what's next. Okay, what happened, we fix as much as we can, fine, but what's next? Fine, okay, so I got to this situation, I'm 30, 40, 50, whatever I am, and I've been doing tshuva for 30 years already, 40 years, 50 years, and then go back right to, like a dog that vomit, runs away from his vomit, and 2 minutes later he comes and eats it. It's like going in a circle, feeling like we're not progressing. So you'd be surprised. One of the most important things in a judgment, that when a person accepted on himself some new things that he wasn't doing before, very seriously, whether he's going to do it or not, only Hashem knows. But we accept it truly, with real intention. Not that we know Hashem, I'm doing this and this and that, and I have already a plan to do it on Wednesday again, 2 days after Rosh Hashanah. So what's the point? But I'm really speaking about, for instance, let's give an example. A common disease in our society for the women is modesty. There's hardly any modest woman, hardly. 1 out of 100 women are modest, from what I've seen in 18 years that I travel to religious places. Not religious places, no one is modest, of course. We're talking those who are aware of modesty. Those who are aware of modesty, almost every from birth woman that you test her on the law of modesty will fail completely on a test. Something so important, nobody bothered to read carefully 2-3 good books and to memorize everything needs to be done with all this new fashion who comes around, all this writing, all these colors, all these stripes, and with the wigs and what's happening today with the shoes and belts and all kinds of things, which, like I said, with no exaggeration, 90% of them are strictly against the halakha. And people are, you know, living with that, and they dream. They dream that maybe we're very modest and I'm special, I'm the only one in my area that like this. But in reality, they're not even passing the test. So at least now, let's say a woman say, you know what, I have 1 week before Rosh Hashanah. Let me really focus on the most important thing for a woman is modesty. Everybody understand. Because all the other sins is between you and Hashem or between you to an individual. It's one and one. You hurt a person, you ask for mechila, he forgive you, it's over. 5 minutes, it's over. You are mechalel Shabbos, you ask for mechila, you receive suffering, can't avoid the suffering, because every one of the 36 restrictions in the Torah that it says karet, v'nichreta nefesh ha'i, that soul get cut, even if a person makes the best superb repentance, the best tshuva, is still subject to some suffering. But don't get too panic, because suffering can even be looking for a coin in a payphone in a cold day and you can't find it, or looking for your car key for 15 minutes when you're in a rush. This is all suffering. So it adds up. A lot of little suffering adds up to one huge amount of suffering. That suffering doesn't have to be, God forbid, cancer or accidents or hospitals and all these tragedies. It can be lots of little sufferings. And it adds up a lot, especially in this generation when people are so spoiled. Every little tiny thing that doesn't work as they expected already make them upset and depressed. People come with high expectation for material lifestyle, materialistic lifestyle, for convenience, for 5 maids, for everything easy. You know, the kids, they throw the kids here, they put them in front of the video and the camp. Let everyone do the job for me as long as I don't have to do that much. With this kind of a lifestyle, every tiny problem is already a lot of suffering. Our grandmother, when they had these things that we have today, they laugh. They, on the way to solve the problem, they laugh. We cry. And Hashem takes it to consideration. Sometimes you see the level of a person. Like we have kids. One is a brilliant kid, and one is a very hard student. It's very hard for him to understand. So the father or the mother, they understand. With this one, you can be strict. With this one, you have to have a lot of patience. So if he gets 70 on a test, you make a party. The other one gets 70, is subject to maybe some kind of a punishment or a strict look that you understand not to repeat that mistake again. So you can see that you judge two individuals completely different. And this is the way Hashem judges us. It's not judging us like the time of the Chafetz Chaim 100 years ago, when you see how people were compared to today, how people used to get married, what was the motto in life, what's the expectation from life, the spiritual level, the modesty level. Like the Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, he spoke before he passed away. He said, 50 years ago, when a woman came to Yerushalayim with a wig, that's his words, people stoned her, took rocks and threw at her, get out of here, we don't want to see you. That's only 3 generations ago. He passed away about 15 years ago, 20 years ago, and he spoke about it that it was about 50 years ago. So we told it 70 years ago, our grandmothers. So the first one came to Yerushalayim like this, they threw rocks at her. Nobody wanted to look at her. Today, anybody's the biggest rebbitzin in the world wear a wig. Everyone looks at her as perfectly normal. It became a way of life. And Hashem takes it into consideration. That's the level of the people. There's nothing he can do. But he said something else. He said that even a blind person saw that it's a wig. That was his words. When she came, it was like a bunch of wool, you know, from a sheep. They put it together. It looked like a very ugly hat. But that's already like shover gader, like breaking the fence, you know, like the Gemara says, someone is a pioneer in making a new moda, new style, which wasn't acceptable up to now, ishachenu nachash. Even if it's not clearly a sin, it could be that it wasn't really, if you judge it, but it's already turning everyone to a separate direction. Same thing, bar mitzvah today. Bar mitzvah became a much a horrible thing today. You ask Rav Chaim Kanievsky, you ask Rav Steinman, all these great rabbis, how was their bar mitzvah? Rav Shach say, my bar mitzvah was, my mother sent me a pair of tefillin to yeshiva. That was it. Rav Chaim Kanievsky bar mitzvah was few pieces of herring, few pieces of cakes, mezones, a little bit l'chaim, that was his bar mitzvah. 2 minutes, bar mitzvah. 5 minutes, I want to say l'chaim, mazal tov, mazal tov, shukizen, that was his bar mitzvah. All the names that you know, that's how it is today. 20,000 here, 50,000 there, 100,000 there, one goes to the Yerushalayim, private jet, 300 people. I already hear about the bar mitzvah that costs more than $1 million. You come to this person and say, you know what, make a tiny bar mitzvah to the family in a house for $5,000 and give $950,000 to kids who cannot afford yeshiva. You get a billions of mitzvot as opposed to one lousy one. Billions. He won't do it. You tell him people are dying. There's a life risk. Pikuach nefesh. Don't burn a million. Say, I'm doing it also. But you can do more. If you save from the Nazis, if you can save every Jew for $1,000 and you give $1 million, so you save many, and you have an extra $500,000 that you're burning on nonsense. So someone comes to you and say, hey, why are you burning this $500,000 on so much nonsense and luxury when people are going into the gas chambers? We can save each one $4,000, give the $500,000, we'll save a lot more. So what is his answer is, but I already gave $1 million. I saved so many. That's an answer of a murderer. That's a fool. What are you looking what you did? You could have saved so many others. We're not talking take your own food and give it to someone. That's already a level. We're talking mandatory things here. So today, everything, it's a show off. And we're following, you know how it is? This is the way the order is. We have the secular Jews, the atheists, the apikorsim, the anti-religion. This is what we call chilonim. So they are leading all the negative fashion. So they are here. And then right after them, you have the Reform Jews. And 10 years after, it's the conservative, which in 10 years, there will be the Reform. And we are 10 years after them. There's the modern, the ultra-modern Orthodox after the conservative, about 10, 20 years after. And we are about 10, 20 years after. So everyone is following the footsteps of the one above him or below him. This is how it is. What people do today and nobody cares about, no one dared to do 40 years ago. We're constantly going lower, lower. So what do we do? Right? We're now 1 week before. So first, we can accept some new things about ourselves. Even we got used to it, even we do it for 30 years, it's not late to change. Technically, the Torah never changed. The Halacha never changed. Modesty is the same modesty. Same modesty Hashem expected from Sarah Imenu, we expect from every woman. It takes into consideration where we live, of course, but technically the Halacha never changed. It's like you go to the court. Like I give you an example. Today, when you leave the United States, if you take more than $10,000, you have to declare. This law is already 50 years, the same law. 50 years ago was 10,000. 50 years ago with $10,000, you could buy a house. Today, you cannot buy even a car with $10,000. But the law never changed. Stupid, should have been upgraded to 50 or to 100,000. That's already money laundering. $10,000, people have one or two kids in yeshiva, they want to give them money for a few months, it's already that amount. I mean, some tzedakah that he wants to give. So it's the law stayed the same. So you come to the judge and say, it's a foolish law. 50 years ago, it made sense. Today, it's a stupid law. Because you are dumb, I have to follow your laws. This, even to a human being judge, it won't work. Still get the punishment. But with Hashem, that took everything to consideration when he gave the Torah, what do you think Hashem didn't know it would be people like us, that everything will be so difficult for them and lots of complaints and so hard and I can't? He saw everything and the Torah is still the same Torah. So what's the solution? First, we have to focus on what we accept to correct our lifestyle. To make some new things that we are not doing correctly. Everyone will examine the way he lives. Whether it's modesty, whether it's Shabbos, whether it's chesed, whether it's accepting guests, whether it's doing for others, whether it's cooking for yeshiva who needs, whether all kinds of things that volunteer works, so many things that we can do. Tzedakah, everyone with his weaknesses. Now there's one more thing. The way of the Satan, the Yetzer Hara, is to destroy us with a very, very tricky trick that he's doing to us. First, he makes us commit the sin, and then we feel lousy about the sin, and now he comes and shows us, you see what a loser you are? How do you want Hashem to accept you? Look at you. How many times you promised not to do it, and you did it again, and then he makes us depressed. And we said for 2-3 days, we don't want to do anything. I don't want to daven, don't want to read Tehillim. What's the point? Anyway, I'm a loser. That's how a person thinks to himself. Anyway, well, what's the point of doing this and this and that? And then come like a hypocrite and read half an hour Tehillim and think that that's going to solve my problems. In the beginning, it worked. But now it doesn't work anymore. Or if I do more chesed, that's going to help me. I'm doing all these bad things that I cannot quit. So, you know, I'm a lost case already. That's how many people think. That's the biggest mistake. Because first of all, a person should never, ever stop being in simcha, even if he made the worst sin in the world. I know it's hard to understand. How can it be? A person made the worst sin can still be happy? Yes. He should regret what he did. He should be ashamed. It's not a contradiction. But still, never to be depressed. Once a person goes into depression, the Satan already have him in his hand, and it's really going to be hard. So it's called Aratzachta Vegam Yarashta. First he murdered us, the Satan, with all his tricks, and then he inherit everything we have. He doesn't leave any a piece of us. He murdered us, fine. He shouldn't be, but it happens. Don't let him take everything left. From here, a person has to right away make a turn and say, that's it, it's not late. Even a million time, person meet the same sin, and a minute before he died, he made tshuva, it's still, Hashem takes it as a tshuva. A million times he made the same sin. A minute before he died, a person, what happened? Hashem is taking it into consideration, and the tshuva is considered. We found many, many cases. I give you an example. There was a Gemara, Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya. What was his sin? He used to go from one prostitute to another. That's what his life was. From one club to another bar, to another woman, to another woman. That's how his life. How, the Gemara called him Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya. He's the biggest criminal. What Rabbi? How he became Rabbi? In 1 hour, he became a rabbi. Without going to Smicha, without going to Ponovich, nothing. So it probably was Am Haaretz at the moment he died. And the Gemara calls him a rabbi. Why? Because there's different levels of tshuva. Some tshuva that a person makes is tshuva mihira. Most of the tshuva we do because we're afraid to lose something. Some women afraid of the children, they're afraid on their health, especially when there's now this epidemic that every other person gets, and Hashem irachem, the machala, is becoming a nightmare. So everyone feels that he lives with a sword on their neck. So because of the fear, people want to make tshuva because they're afraid to be surprised, like so many cases around them. Everyone lives with this fear. Now, Iran, atomic bomb, atomic war, what's going to be, especially for those who live in Israel, there's a lot of stress right now. So people do tshuva because of fear. And even if the situation was ideal, no war, no epidemics, no, still people do out of fear. To lose the parnasa, to lose their shidduch, not to get married, not to marry their children. There's so many maybes that a person lives with this constant fear and it makes him make tshuva. Don't get me wrong. I wish all the Jews in the world would make this kind of tshuva and the Mashiach would come. So it wouldn't be ideal, but there would be no reshaim. So most people do tshuva from fear. Some of them later becomes out of love. It's very rare to find someone who really does tshuva from love. I had a case like this. I went one time to Great Neck to a learning program to speak. And one person called me before. He said, listen, I'm bringing my friend. It was a 21 years old kid from Great Neck, rich kid. Parents bought him a $50,000 car. He has a lot of money in his pocket. Very handsome boy, long hair, living with all the girls there, making scenes, who knows what. And he said, I'm bringing him to you. I have 45 minutes to speak to him. It was a miracle to save a boy in this situation. I started to speak to him after 20 minutes, and believe me, without proofs, without fear, without anything. I just spoke to him about few things, maybe 2 or 3 subjects, with the Chumash open. I showed him some verses in the Torah, and started to cry. What crying? And you never saw any other. Mamash, I got chills all over my body when I saw how this boy started to cry. didn't know Judaism, didn't go to yeshiva, public school, grew up, mamash. Started to cry like this, what a Russia, how did I do it to Hashem? Mamash like this. And right away, he became a tzaddik within weeks. He's in yeshiva in Yerushalayim now. He has a neshama, like once in a blue moon you find. But tshuva me'ahava. Even you tell him, you know, Michael, don't worry. You are dismissed from punishments. No punishments for you. You can do whatever you want. Love that he has for Hashem already. It's really tshuva me'ahava. You can see right away, it's tshuva me'ahava. I had another kibbutznik from kibbutz Bet Hashita. 7 minutes I spoke to him. 7 minutes. Then I gave him a Mesilas Yesharim book. That's it. From then on, his way all the way up was very, very fast. Went to yeshiva in Netivot Olam, in Bnei Brak. Grew up a long beard, was very serious. Come from the kibbutz that I saw anti-religion, where all the pickles and olives that we buy from comes from kibbutz Bet Hashita. That's where he comes from. Very anti-religion. When he wanted to bring me to speak in a kibbutz, they lay down in a gate that I won't get come in. If a priest come, they welcome him with a red rug. No exaggeration. We have to be, you know, democracy, liberal, freedom of speech. Everyone, freedom of speech for everyone, no rabbis is allowed. Same thing in the army. Freedom of speech, an Arab wants to come to speak about the Palestinian things, the Christian, everyone, but speaking about becoming Baal Tshuva is not allowed here. That's the way it is. So that's called Tshuva Me'ahava. Most people do out of fear. What's the difference? When you do out of fear, you can erase all the sins, but they're not turning into mitzvot. They just erase your sins. If you don't have mitzvot, you don't have mitzvot. You have to come back in Gilgul, reincarnation, start from the beginning. You got lucky, you got away with the debt. The credit card was all the way up to the sky with penalty and interest, and it got wiped out. So that's it. So you don't owe anything, but you don't have a penny. Come to Olam Haba, you're very poor. Hashem doesn't have what to pay you. At least you got your balance to zero. It was a negative billion, it went to zero. It's a great achievement. But it could have turned into a positive billion. It could be a credit in your account if it would be tshuva from ahava. That's the word of the Gemara. So the Gemara said, tshuva me'ahava ne'afchim lo l'schuyot. The zdonot, all the intentional sins become mitzvot, which actually you get a reward for it. So this Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, after he made all these sins, he went to one of these prostitutes and she told him, you are a lost case. Even if you ever want to become a normal human being, God won't accept you. She shook him up. He started to realize the situation. And he started to cry. He went here, he went there. He was begging nature, the trees, the rivers, the mountains, pray for me, do something. He was crying and crying and crying from bitterness until he died. He died from tshuva, from crying. How many people die because they cry from repentance? How many? So the Gemara say, bat kol, yatsa bat kol, is like an announcement in a court of heaven, Rabbi Elazar ben Dordaya, mezuman l'chaya olam haba. He's welcome to the olam haba, to the afterlife. How he became Rabbi, all his horrible sins turn into mitzvot. There's no other way. But if he would just regret, ashamed, stop doing what he did, and start doing mitzvot, yeah, he get rid of the sins, but he won't turn into zchuyot. So now we have an opportunity now to do tshuva me'ahava, still alive. Tshuva me'ahava is not because of the fear from the punishment. It's not because of the fear we're afraid to lose parnasa, we're afraid to get fired, we're afraid to have problems with the kids, all kinds of things that we always live with this fear. Tshuva me'ahava, it's a much higher level. Is how can I be ungrateful to Hashem? Forget about punishment. Even I know there's no punishments at all. Nothing at all. How can I be so ungrateful? I get so much and I return so little. This is what Rav Steinman, they just made a new book about him. That's his famous sentence. How would I come in front of Hashem? He gives me so much and I give so little back. He said, he gives so little back. What we got to say? So the idea is, how can I be ungrateful? Hashem is so great for me. He does so much for me. Focus on what you have. Focus on the opportunities you have. Those who are married. Why are you taking it for granted? Now, how many couple, how many people in the world, how many hundreds of thousands of Jews never got married? Don't have, they didn't find. And it's not ugly people, not poor people, not sick people. It could be handsome and wealthy and smart. I meet all these kind of people, you wonder, how these people never got married? You see, it's all gzera mishamayim. It's nothing to do with your look or how much you have and your wisdom or your yichus. Mamash like this. So mamash is gzera anador. You know how many couples don't have kids? 15% don't have kids. 15% are barren. Baruch Hashem, with Hashem mercy, today they have all these treatments so they can help, and they make a lot of them eventually have kids and twins and triplets, etc. But until they came up with all this technology 20 years ago, 15% of the couples just can't have kids. 14, 15 years of frustration, trying, depression, breaking their heart, and those who have kids complain. Wow, how can I? It's too much. If I knew it's going to be too hard, maybe I would ask for a rabbi to give me an heter, all kinds of things that I hear. A person has to appreciate what he has. Everyone is jealous with what the materialism of the other instead of the spirituality. Yeah, a person has to be jealous with his friend that he's more righteous than me. If the woman is more righteous than me, which means she's more modest than me, and she's more baalat chesed, and she's less jealous than me, and she's more giving up, and she's a better wife than me, this is what I have to be jealous with. Not if she got a new car and she drive a fancy whatever and she goes on vacation once or twice a year. That's nonsense. All these things, it's like a blink of the eye before you realize will be over. You have to focus on the spirituality. That's called kinat sofrim tarbe chokma. When a person is jealous with the spirituality of the other, that's a mitzvah. It's only one permission to be jealous, with the spirituality of your friend. He's better than me. May I be like him? If I won't be jealous with him, I may not be like him. If I'm jealous with him, he finished 5 masachtot and I'm only 4, let me compete with him. So I do another masachet. Everyone is happy. Hashem is happy. The world is a better place to live. More Torah, more mitzvot, better for me, better for my children. Many people benefit from this jealousy. But any other jealousy is completely negative. And today there's a lot of gossip, lashon hara, for stupid things. Do you see how they did this? You see that they do that? See, I'm doing 3 times, she is only 2 times. That, how come her husband buy her a jewel every birthday and you buy me only once a year? All kinds of things that went to our society. These things, they have no room in a religious society. In a religious society, material things should not make any impression on life of a person. Fine, women like jewelry, they like nice clothing, but there has to be a limit to it. Once you become addicted to it, they destroy your spirituality. You never find a woman that is in love so much with this kind of lifestyle that she's in love with Hashem. It cannot be. One comes on the expense of the other. Same thing a man. Man is in love with watches and suits and shoes and cars and vacations and first class and all kinds of food. How can he be a Talmid Chacham? You ever saw one like this that has patience to sit and learn and sweat on a Gemara? Nah, everything is like we say in Hebrew, Chafif. An hour here and there, it's called Latzet Lidei Chova. Not to be considered Mevatel Torah. Daf Yomi, 45 minutes, his mind is already in a business. You as the wives, in case you have a husband like this, you as a wife have a big responsibility. Because you may think, what can I do? I tried, I spoke to him, he doesn't listen. I'm modest, yes. I'm Shomer Shabbos fully, yes. I'm doing lots of chesed, yes. I'm taking care of the children, I read Tehillim, I pray. I'm good, I'm not speaking Lashon Hara. I always, Baruch Hashem, working on my personality, my midot. That's his problem. Everyone goes to his world. Adam olech leolamo. When someone passed away, they write on the head, on the wall, Halach leolamo. Went to his own world. So the question is, what do you mean, Alach leolamo? Alach leolam haba, or niftar. Niftar means passed away and moved on. Alach leolamo. Olamo means olam shelo, his world. Because every person in a creation has his own world, in his level. There's no two people that reach exactly the same mark. It's impossible. You live 60, 70, 80 years, you're doing billions of things, the chance that you and another individual will do everything exactly the same and you reach the same exact score is 1 to 1 trillion. It's really no chance. That's why every person already can be a little bit more or a little bit less. And the Gemara says that tzaddikim, the righteous people in heaven, nichvim michupatam shel chaveram. They're one level below. You have billions of level. One tiny level below. you see the friend that did one extra mitzvah more than you in your life, you're already very jealous with him. And this is in Olam HaEmet, in the world of the truth. Because you think, wow, I could have done this mitzvah 50 times a day if I wanted. Why didn't I do it? For one more time, his world is much greater than mine. They have this famous story about the Gaon Mivilna and his wife, and the Magid Miduvna and his wife. The Gaon Mivilna, he was the biggest rabbi, at least in Europe, perhaps in the whole world, about 250 years ago. And his wife was a very righteous Rebbitzin, and he hired the second biggest rabbi in Europe, the Magid Miduvna, which was the best lecturer, to be his policeman, to watch him, to give him musar, to tell him what he does wrong, and he paid him a salary. So every time he came to give him money, he said, why are you giving me money? It's my obligation anyway. Between Jew to a Jew, we have to be mochiach. Ochiach tochiach et amitecha. Improve the ways of your friends, no? So he said to him, no. If I don't pay you, you tell me, but when it's embarrassing, you won't tell me. Now when I pay you, you must tell me, otherwise you're a thief. Take the money and not doing your job. And I know you won't be a thief. I'm hiring you to tell me what I'm doing wrong. This is a perfect human being that slept half an hour, three times a day. Half an hour, never more than that. And all his life learned Torah, and after 50 years he saw his sister. 50 years he did not see her, there was no Google, no searching in the internet for her, putting in a newspaper, putting an ad on television, there was none of these things. She's somewhere in the world and you are there and you never see each other. By a miracle she located him after 50 years. They didn't see each other since they were teenagers. He saw her, two old people meeting after 50 years. You know today how they make a party, they bring CNN, balloons, everyone clapping, 5,000 people, it's all over the magazines. They already make a story in Hollywood. He got up, he came out, 1 minute. He came out of his room, he said, sister, I love you very much. Very happy to see you. You're alive, you had your life, Baruch Hashem. But in this world, there's no time to waste. Thank you very much, we'll meet in the afterlife. Went back to his room and learned. This is the level of the person we're talking here. So he hired the Magid Miduvna to be his policeman. So apparently the wives became friends. The husband together, the wives became friends. So they did lots of acts of chesed. They did chesed activity, kindness. So they used to go collect charity from the rich and give to the poor. So they made an agreement between them that whoever passed away first will come in a dream, if there's permission from Shamayim, to her friend to tell her how is it in the afterlife, what's going on over there. So the wife of the Magid Miduvna passed away first. And then after a while she came to the wife of the Gaon Mivilna in a dream, and she told her, you have no idea how great where I am and this and that. But you are higher than me. She said. So she said, why am I higher than you? Everything we did together. So she told about all the tzedakah who got her to a very high level in Olam Haba. She said, because when we went to collect tzedakah, we were talking to the owner of the house, and you were the one who reached your hand to receive the tzedakah. So every time you have a little bit more embarrassment than me. Because who gets more embarrassed? The one who goes like this. I want to stand next. I'm just passing by, you know. I'm not really asking anything. So you got more embarrassment. That's why I cannot get to your level in the Olam Haba. It's tiny things. So it's just to show us how one little tiny thing can change everything around. So let's focus on what I started before. So one way not to be depressed is to focus on the good we do. But if we focus too much on the good we do, then we stop doing anything. So I'm set already. Baruch Hashem, I have enough. When it comes to money, did you ever see a wealthy man that gets to X amount of money and say, you know what, I don't want to make more money. I'll take the money that I deserve, give it to someone else. Give it to someone else. You never found anyone. He's 90 years old. He still wants to collect his money. He's thinking, my grandchildren. Nobody ever say, you know what, I already have $1 billion. I'm tired of making money. Enough. How many years I'm going to use this money? Give it to the... Transfer it to this yeshiva, transfer it to this orphan house. You don't see it. But when it comes to mitzvot, the Yetzer Hara convinces us every once in a while, you're good. You had a good period now you can relax. You finished the Tehillim so many times, take a week off. go later something, I don't know, by a kosher pool there, Baruch Hashem, go on vacation, relax. On the vacation, you don't need tehillim. Modesty, you can cheat a little bit. Anyway, you go back to Monsi, you go back to normal, to your friends. Over there, there's no place to cheat. Over here, you can be half. You think I'm crazy when I'm telling you this. I'm talking to you from experience, from what's happening in our community. People who go to places, the Jew not supposed to even step there, and then go to places, I don't want to tell you, and they come back here and they look mamash like a rabbi and a rebbitzin. But when they go over there, they hide their beard, they put this, they put baseball hat, all of a sudden Vinny and Christine. And they come here, Baruch Hashem is a big rebbe and a rebbitzin. From knowledge I'm talking, from knowledge. So what's going on here? Who do you fool? You fake? Who are you faking? Remember, if we are fakers and we are only righteous next to people, that's the worst. Nothing will count because it's all a show. That's why a person has to be real. Wherever you are, you have to be real. Whether you're alone in a house, whether you're in the end of the world, whether you got to the moon even, no one sees you. Whether a person is in a bathroom, there's halachot how to behave in a bathroom. Who cares in a bathroom? As a person, the way he gets dressed, yeah, it's fine, it's midat chassidut. Maybe not that many people makpid on it. Midat chassidut, when a person gets dressed, he put the blanket and he changes his pants under the blanket. So a person think, well, Hashem is blind. The blanket is making it more tzanua. It doesn't free through the blanket. Or the Gemara that they ask Kim Chit. She had seven sons. Each one of them was a Kohen Gadol. When in the history something like this happened? If a woman had one son in a time of Bet HaMikdash that got to the top of the pyramid to become the most important person in the world, the Kohen Gadol is already higher than a king even, and is a holy person. He goes into Kodesh HaKodashim along with Hashem in Yom Kippur, and he comes out alive. It's a guarantee. It's a stamp from Hashem. Badatz, not badatz, million badatz from Hashem. Not from the Ashgacha. Sometimes it's good, sometimes not. Directly from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He was with me in Kodesh HaKodashim and didn't die. That means he's the most righteous person. She had seven like this. What is your schut? There's a lot of righteous women in the world. None of them had such a schut. Seven? Imagine a woman had seven sons. Each one of them is Gdol Ador. You ever see such thing? Some are more, some are less, but each one of them became the biggest rabbi in the world, one after the other. It's very unlikely to happen. So they ask her, what's your schut? She said, I'm so modest that even the walls of my house never saw my body. Or when she was taking a shower, she put sheets around. And of course, it doesn't make any difference whether she did, she didn't do, she got extra dress, she covered. HaKadosh Baruch Hu see one way or the other, but it's not really it. It's to show Hashem how much I'm trying. How much I'm trying. The righteous people in the old days, when they saw in a month of Elul, the entire year passed with no suffering. The Torah said, Asher Yoav Hashem Yeyasro. Someone Hashem loves, he smack him. Love patch. Sometimes the love patch is very painful. But if he loves you, he sends you all kinds of struggling and aggravation and problems and little tragedies and sometimes big tragedies. And a person complains, why do I deserve it? I'm trying to do everything I can. Why Hashem is doing it to me? Where is the justice? That's a very big mistake. The opposite, a person should say, thank you Hashem, you're cleaning me here. In a short period of time you're cleaning me than a long process. Better short process cleaning than a much longer over there, which is much more painful. Better to get clean here. But the people complain. But Hashem said, Asher Yoav Hashem Yeyasro, Asher Yeyaser Ish Et Bno, Kach Hashem Elokecha Meyasreka. The same way a father loves his son and he's strict with him. If he loves him, he's strict with him. Not everything take and enjoy. No, that's wrong. Good and bad. The right hand pulling him towards you and the left hand is more strict. Both hands are merciful and bringing him closer. This kid sometimes porke all. They got used to get everything. Every year, new bike. Everything, the best shoes, the best thing. Now we have a new habit now. Every girl, she wants $80 shoes and she refused to get another shoes. Why everyone in her class has this brand? You look at that, you don't understand what's the difference between the $15 shoes to the $80, no difference whatsoever. It's some name on it. Things like this do not belong in a religious society. Or guys in yeshiva, they come, they check the suit, the tie, one of each other, or the suit. What is this? What does it have to do with religion? This is the opposite of religion. All kinds of things. Comparing houses. Where do you live? Where I live? Where he lives? What car his father has? This is mamash like in a secular environment, society, 100%. Like I said, it's 20 years after them. And God forbid, in 20 years, the way you see them today, that's how we're going to look in 20 years, Hashem Erachem. We already, look at our youths, what's happening. It's an epidemic. Thousands, thousands of kids in drugs, in alcohol, in problems, do not go to school, cannot learn 1 minute. All the bombs in the streets, in the mountains, what's happening? You go there, you cry. Go in Wesley, see what's happening there. See how the girls are dressed. I didn't go in Wesley's for many, many years. I had to go there a few weeks ago. For a minute, I thought I'm in Tel Aviv. Every other woman that was walking there with tight pants, I said, can I walk in here? What? That's 5 minutes from Muncie. This is a religious city, no? It's considered a religious city. On the main road there, by the stores, by the supermarket, half of the people who come there are complete secular. And this is people who are now still Shomer Shabbos, but completely dressed like secular, like Goyim, completely. So the question is, where will they be, these people, in 10, 15 years from now, if they continue to drop? And that's what happened. When a person doesn't hear Musar, most people are avoiding Musar. They don't want to hear Musar. Why? It makes them feel guilty. So they don't like the feeling, so they don't want to hear it. Because they don't get it, it's like a person who needs antibiotic and he doesn't get it. What happens to his infection? It's growing. So when you ask him, why are you not taking your antibiotic? He says, it makes me weak, it makes me sad, I cannot focus, whatever. He gives his excuses. But what happened in the meantime? The infection is growing and growing until you have to chop a piece from the body and a person dies. And that's what happens to us spiritually. We have to be clever to stop it, not to let the society drag us into the worst place that we don't want to be there. How do you know if a fish is alive? You see millions of fish coming with the waves towards the beach. They all die. There's a poisoning, let's say, oil leak. So you have millions of fish coming with the waves. All of a sudden, you see one of them is swimming against the waves. So you see everyone is dead. They're all coming together. And this one is alive. He finds his own direction. We are still alive and we can choose our direction. So if we see that we have friends that are dragging us into this phony lifestyle, we should try to stay away from these people and stick to people who are much higher than us and will bring us into a more simple lifestyle, more spiritual lifestyle, more modest lifestyle, lifestyle with no galashon hara, with no competition, who has better jewelry and all this nonsense. Something that he will help me to be like him, or she will help me to be like her. That's the right way. Tell me who your friend, I tell you who you are. That's the rule. If this is your friend, and you not care about him, like I one time say about a group of people who are doing something horrible, big chilul Hashem, but not the entire group is like this. Half of the people are like this, the other half are normal. So one person asked me, can I pray in that place? I say, absolutely not. I say, well, there's a lot of good people there. I say, yeah. But the fact that these good people are still in the same place with the bad people, and they marry their children together, and they eat kugel together, and they drink l'chaim together, and there's no problem with them, they're just as bad as them. It doesn't bother them what they do. So just as bad as them. In 5 years, they'll be like them. It doesn't give them goosebumps that I'm with this kind of people in a synagogue. I've got to run from here. Someone curses Hashem in a synagogue, you can pray with him in the same place. If someone goes against all Gdolei Ador and they do horrible things, you can sit with them like everything is normal in a shul and sing with them and daven with them and give them aliyah, everything is fine. What's going on here? So if we are like this, if we have friends like this, if we're not as bad as them, we'll be in a year or two. That's it. The influence, the person is the product of his environment. Everyone. You know, there's...
If you're in Kiruv,
yeah. First of all, in Kiruv, you need a special siyata dishmaya because it's very dangerous to do Kiruv, and I'll tell you why. The Gemara says, Rabbi Yossi walked on the street, and a very wealthy man, a president of a community, came to him and said, Retzoncha shetavo etagur itanu, if you come to live with us, I'm going to give you a lot of gold and silver and everything you want. Just name it and we'll give you. Very wealthy in our place. We don't have a rabbi. We want you to come teach us Torah. So they live in a very rich area. There's no Torah over there. And they take one of the chief rabbis of Israel. They're offering him a job. Fantastic salary. Today, if they put an ad like this, 500 would stand online. Everyone would want the job. But Rabbi Yossi said to him, if you give me all the gold and all the silver in the world, I don't leave a place of Torah. I can only go to live in a place of Torah, which means the Torah is already there. They need kiruv, fine, but at least I have something for my children. I'm not going to sacrifice my own children to save strangers. So even if a person saves 100 strangers and he lost 5 of his kids because of the choice he made, it's not a mitzvah for him. Because ani yair hakodmim, your family is your own flesh. They come first. They come first. If your son, oh, turn the, yeah. No. Turn, just, no, it just, yeah, no, to the other side. That's it, thank you. That's it, thank you. All right, so, your son comes first. There's no point, okay, also today, if the kids are very, very little, they don't understand yet, you want to bring some guests to the house, fine. But once they understand what's going on, and you know, and also there are two different kinds of kids. Some kids who are automatically attracted to everything negative. Whatever they see negative, right away they go to copy. Kids like this, if you have one like this, you cannot bring any secular people to your house, even relatives, nothing. Cannot bring them in. If your kids are comfortable, a righteous soul, they're not interested in that, goyish, they don't want to look at that, you have to be very careful. You have to train the guest what to do, what not to do, what to say, what not to say, because they talk. They don't understand. They don't mean bad, but they begin to talk about things. All of a sudden, they pull up cards, they begin to play, or one of them changes his chair, and you see his tattoos, all kinds of things like this. What happened the next day? The kids come, take markers, and they draw tattoos, one on the other. And then if they see he has a special iPad, and in the beginning it's let me play a game, and another game, and they see this, and it attracts their attention, soon it's going to be bar mitzvah. That's what he's going to ask. From here to total destruction, it's a year or two. 14, 15, smokes, next thing drugs, next thing doesn't want to go to school. That's what happened to a lot of families because of kiruv. You got to be very careful. Do kiruv out of the house. The more you do, the better it is. Plus, there's another way to do kiruv with remote control. Sponsor CDs. We send CDs all the time to these people. 30 hours of proofs, lectures, $1 each. So take your miser, you, your husband, whatever, sponsor CDs. We send anyone you say, send to this family, send here. Send them a pack, DVD, CDs. It's a game of numbers. Some listen, some right away change. That's it. Now they change. They already Shomer Shabbos, this. Oh, now you can invite them. Invite them to your house and they do what they do in front of your kids. It's very dangerous. Al zeh Shlomo HaMelech say, al tiyeh tzadik harbe. You try to do too much, in the end you're left with nothing. Grab to what you have. Better one bird in your hand than two on a tree. So you got to be very careful. First, second, not everyone is capable of doing kiruv. Some people are weak character. When they come across this kind of people, they become like them. They lower their level to bring these people to, supposedly to Torah, but without realizing, after a year or two, they almost became like them. They become very modern, everything is half enough, they're already not so honest, they're already using dirty words, they're not really feeling it. Why? Because they're among these people and they became a part of them. That's not the way of doing kiruv. It's not a way of doing kiruv. You'll be surprised. There's questions in halacha about kiruv. How to believe that if a person knows he's going to go even a little bit down on his level, he should never do. But if he knows he's strong and these things disgust him and he's been there already, he tasted from all this garbage and he doesn't want to even think about it, and then the opposite, the more he's with them, the more disgusted it is from their lifestyle. Okay, so it's not affecting him so much. So it's in and out. It's in and out. What is it like? It's pouring outside. You run quickly to your car, but you run right inside, so your suit doesn't get ruined. But you stand outside 5-10 minutes with pouring rain. That's it. You cannot save the suit. In and out, or in and out of the oven, you're not getting burned. But staying there too long, you may never come out of there. So you got to be very careful. So the idea of kiruv is not in your own living room. Your kids are away, all of them grew up, they're already in yeshivot, no one is in the house. No problem, of course, why not? You and your husband are mature already, you can bring them, no problem. Mitzvah, big mitzvah. So this is about Kiruv. Now let's conclude. So to be depressed, it's a big sin. There's no permission to be depressed. No permission. And there's no reason to be depressed. Even, remember, even if a person makes horrible sins, it's much, much faster and easier than you think to turn into the positive way. All we have to do is to do tshuva me'ahava, and even some of these sins that we are crying on can turn into mitzvot and good points in our file. So there's really no point to be depressed. As long as we can do something, we can save. You know, there was the Maharil Midiskin. He heard that his aunt, she's in a hospital. She was an older lady. So he was in town, so he went to visit her. He came, he knocked on the door, can I go see my aunt? So yeah, you can go in. He comes, he sees she connects to all kinds of machines, pipes. And the smell in the room was horrible. And now this is a long time ago, so the hospitals were not as modern and nice like today. So it's already old and dirty and who knows what. And on top of that, she's very sick. She cannot go to the bathroom. You don't have to tell you what's going on over there. So, you know, he's already there. What is he going to do? He said, let me suffer 10 minutes. Mitzvat bikur cholim. So after she said to him, he was her nephew. So she said to him, give me a bracha that I should live long life. That's what she asked him. He couldn't hold his thoughts. And he said, I don't understand. Excuse me for saying it, but every other person in your situation will already want to go to heaven. Be here in this place. Why do you want to live long life? So she got very serious. We can learn a lot from this in life. It's a true story. She got very, I don't want to say angry, but very serious. And she looked at him and she said, shame on you. Once a week the nurse come and change the bags with all my bathroom and put new bags. And for 2 hours the place is clean and I'm able to read Tehillim and to pray. And you ask me why I want to live long life? 2 hours a week I have an opportunity to read Tehillim. That's it. Nothing else she can do in her life. She's laying in bed, connected to this, all these horrible things there. And horrible smell. She cannot pray with the bathroom on her body. But once they replace and they clean the room, the room becomes clean. Oh, so the room is not a bathroom anymore. I cannot pray inside the bathroom. Oh, but now it became a normal room. 2 hours, 3 hours. I can praise Hashem. And you ask me why I want to live? No, tell it to our wives today. You want to live this kind of life? 2 hours a week, you can read the Ilim and the rest, you'll be in the garbage. So kill me right now, here. No one would agree. But this is only one or two generations ago. Just to show you what's happening here. So, but, remember, the Gemara say, Iftach bedoro keshmuel bedoro. That's the good news. What's the good news? Shmuel and Iftach is like comparing a person to a monkey. It's nothing to compare. Shmuel was in a level of Moshe and Aaron combined. Shmuel in the time of David HaMelech, 3,000 years ago. Iftach is hundreds of years ago, later, and is nothing compared to the level of Shmuel in holiness and Torah. But Iftach in his generation was a key person, one of the Gdolim. So the Gemara say, every generation has his rabbis. Shmuel was 3,000 years ago, and Iftach was hundreds of years later. Is nothing compared to Shmuel, but compared to his generation, he's a gadol. Noach ish tzadik tamim bedorotav. What does Chazal say? Only according to all the wicked people. If it was in a different generation, it would be an ordinary person. But in his generation, he's a shining diamond. You know, so the same thing us. Compared to our generation, with all our sins and all our problems, we're still a shining diamond. Compare. So the sins, yes, it's not as bad as it used to be 500 years ago when people were in a much higher level. But Hashem knows who he's dealing with. He knows, and he sees us, he sees them. Don't expect him to be like him. But we cannot take advantage on it. So, you know, since it's such a bad generation, compared to our everyone, I'm okay, I'll stay like this. No, shalom aleich nafshi. That's a very big mistake. If a person only look at his positive, he will only go down. A person should balance, should look at his negative to wake up, but at the same time not to be depressed, to look at the positive. After all, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I did that, I'm so happy I was able to do this, I'm hosting lectures in my house, I'm giving tzedakah, I improve my modesty. You know, I want to tell you something about modesty. You know, like 2-3 years ago, I don't remember how long ago was that they said that all the wigs are not kosher, they come from India, and all the women threw the wigs. So one girl, in Kol Yaakov, in Eretz Israel, in Bnei Brak, the teacher, first time ever, she came to class without a wig. No, the girls never saw her before with covering her head. They only saw her wig. So they asked right away, what happened? They didn't know, little kids. That's 8, 9, 10 years old. So she said, didn't hear the news? Rav Eliashiv said that all the wigs are not kosher, cannot wear them anymore. So right away, one girl in the class, she took off her wig and stayed bald. She had the cancer, lo aleinu. She took it in front of everyone and stayed bald all day. And no one knew that she has it. Didn't tell anyone. So why you took it off? She said, well, if the Gdol Ador said not to put it, I'm not putting it. Look at the neshama of a tzadeket. She took it off. In her case, it's a different story. We're not talking now modesty issues. We're talking mamash. Big embarrassment for her. But she took it in front of everyone and she refused to put it back. You know, they made a film. It was really shocking. I'm afraid to say it. I don't want you to get it in the wrong way. Don't take it anything personal, please. But I'm just telling you what the film is. If you have complaints, go to the one who made the film. They made a film about the modesty in Bnei Brak. So the film over there, they interview an Israeli secular doctor from the cancer unit in a hospital in Tel Aviv. And he confirmed that the 2 weeks between this day to that day, that's exactly from the time Rav Eliashiv said that no one is allowed to wear wig and everyone has to throw their wigs until everyone put their wigs back on, that it turns to be a false alarm, that 2 weeks. The amount of children in the cancer unit went from 84 to 3. And the secular doctor, which has nothing to do with religion, you see how he looks in the video, he said, I confirmed that something like this never happened in the history of the hospital since I work here. Always 70, 80, 90, those numbers, constantly. All of a sudden, mamash, there was no, Baruch Hashem, no one coming those 2 weeks. The hospital, mamash, was empty. No kids. 3 kids for 2 weeks. Mamash, a clear miracle. Now you can come and say, well, how do you know it's because of that? Whatever. We can find excuses. But it never happened before. So maybe Hashem sent a message. Maybe it's time to improve our modesty. Also, at the same time, if a husband sees that his wife is weak, she's weak. That's her weakness. To make too much of an issue of that and arguments and fights in the house and ruin the marriage in the house is also very stupid to do. It has to be clever. It has to be with nice talking, with convincing, with giving her gifts, talking to her heart, giving example, giving tapes, asking another girl to convince her, but definitely never through a fight. And even if in the end she doesn't stay modest, even though in the old generation they say that a woman who goes out to the street not modest, she loses her ketubah right away. But all the Gdolei Ador today, we must listen to them. They say, no, you cannot reach today anything with war. Same thing in Chinuch. In the old generation, you come to a kid and you give him one time a smack, in the next 20 years there won't be any problems. Today you give a kid a smack, it's almost guaranteed he'll go off the derech. He will just wait for the moment that he can be independent with some friends on his Facebook and this and rebel against you. He won't even come sleep home. He'll manage, he'll find a job. He will do everything he can to prove to you he doesn't depend on you. Why? You give him smack here and there. You care for him, he will not forgive you. Not to talk about the kids who call the police and get you into trouble, and then the next thing you find, they take your other kids away. That's what's happening today. You run into problem with your oldest. The next thing, this fool can get you into such problem. The next thing they come, Chas v'Shalom, take the little kids. Because they're not exactly in love with the Jews. And when they come and they see, oh, you know what, there's an opportunity to take 3-4 kids to foster care, Believe me, some of them would be happy, more than happy to do it. And I've seen what's happening out there. Right away, social worker come, checking, leading the kids to say something that would sound like you're probably torturing them. Tomorrow, Chas v'Shalom, he break his hand or something, goes to the hospital right away, they report, oh, it's a second incident. Who wants to live in fear like this? So today, there is no room anymore for smacks, nothing, hardly punishments. It's much better to focus on rewarding. If they don't learn good, I'll give you this, I'll buy you, even if you have to take a loan. I'll do this for you, I'll do that for you, I'll give you that, whatever, almost everything you want, as long as it doesn't get him off the way, right? But just to give them incentive to learn and to be good and things like this. It doesn't work. It just not, in this generation, החוצפה תסגה. The chutzpah is in such level, it's just not working. The wars do not work. You see, sometimes you fight with someone, he's weak, he surrenders, that's it, the problem is over. But the kids today are not surrendering. Especially when they know there's hundreds like me everywhere here. I go here, I go there, I find a lot. They're all like me. You know what they say in Hebrew? Tzarat rabim, chatzi nechama. The answer to that is, tzarat rabim nechama tipshim. But what do people think? If a boy fell in a class, and the rabbi reads his mark first, Moishi, 40, fell, feel horrible. Then the next one, Itzi, 42, fell. Avi, 35, fell. The more people fell after him, makes him feel better, until he begins to smile. Ah, it's so great, what a wonderful day. An hour ago, I was ready to die. Now, I said, wow, I'm not the only loser. Everyone fell. I feel great about it. Technically, did it change his situation to any better? No. He's still the same one. He still failed. He won't get his GED, whatever. He won't, whatever he needs to get. He won't become what he wanted to become. Later, when he's going to be homeless one day, will it comfort him that I wasn't the only one? There was another 25 like me in the class, and they all did not graduate? What does it help you? Same thing us. When there's so many seniors out there, when there's so many ladies not modest out there, so we feel, you know, it's so good. I'm not the only one. Everyone is like this. Cannot be everyone goes to Gehenom. Cannot be. Right? That's how a person thinks. Everyone speaks Lashon Hara. Everyone speaks in Shul. That's how people are. Now just someone told me, he daven in Young Israel in some community. Some people started to talk there. So the rabbi say, I want everyone to sign that if they come to daven in the Shul, they sign that they won't talk. So many people sign, and some people refuse to sign. So he told me, I didn't sign. I said, why didn't sign? I know already I'm going to talk. Why would I sign? Lo sif chet al pesha. I already know I cannot close my mouth. So now I'm going to sign. I'm going to violate another rule, promising and not keeping my word. He doesn't know that one way or the other is still a major violation. This is, by the way, one of the only sins that the Torah permits to insult a person in public. If a person speaks in shul and he got a warning to stop and he continue, the Shulchan Aruch say in the Rambam, Mevayshim oto, you embarrassed him in public, you grab him and throw him out of the shul in front of everyone. Don't let him. Mamash, close, block the way from him. You're not welcome here, don't come here. Find anyone who has the guts to do it. We're not doing it. But really, Shulchan Aruch permits. The only place you're allowed to embarrass a person in public is this. Maybe there's other ways, but this is, you know how Amalbin Pnei Chavero Barabim Keilu Shofech Damim En Lo Chelek La'olam Haba. If you embarrass a person in public, it's like spilling his blood, you have no share to the world to come. Horrible things. Over here, mitzvah. You, get up, leave the shul. No, okay, I'll be quiet. No, it's too late. We gave you enough warnings, grab him from his hair, throw him out of the door, don't come here anymore. And 300 people are looking. Who has the guts to do it? Mitzvah. Count for your mitzvah. So show you how horrible it is to talk in a shul. So if a person knows he's talking in a shul, better not to go to the shul. Speaking about shul, we are 1 week before Rosh Hashanah. I don't know if you go to shul every Shabbos to daven. If you go to Yom Tov in shul, some of you may have young kids, it's impossible. Better not to go to shul if your kids are younger than 5. Don't take kids younger than 5 years old to the synagogue, they disturb everyone. It's called mitzvah abba be'avera. It's a sin who gets involved with a mitzvah who gets involved with a sin. It's not a mitzvah. Mitzvah abba be'avera, it's not a mitzvah. Zero mitzvah, nothing. Only the avera stayed. The mitzvah is gone. So, if you have little kids, no babysitter, no older sister who can watch them or whatever, you dismissed. You stay at home, it's a bigger mitzvah, even in Yom Kippur, even in Rosh Hashanah, even if you don't hear the shofar. Yeah, because to disturb the people, especially in a day like this, that people get angry, it's a much, much bigger sin for you. However, if you don't have kids, or the grandma can watch them, or the, one of the neighbors, or whatever, or maybe you can do shifts. You and the neighbor, you watch the kids in one davening, the first Yom Tov, and she the second Yom Tov. You be creative. But if you go to the synagogue, it's an opportunity. It's still, even though a woman doesn't need a minyan, but it's still a level. It's a better level than to pray alone, even for a man. For a woman, the same thing. Some places used to do minyan for women and take out the Torah and read. You know that? 10 women used to do it without the brachot, but they did as much as they can. Some women put tefillin. There are women who are not Reform, Orthodox, but they do it not publicly. They don't want to look like they are Reform. But there's a mitzvah to put tefillin. If a woman is clean, no need after mikveh and that, she can take her husband tefillin and put it once. And to the best of my knowledge, the Ashkenazi women can even make a bracha. Because mitzvat aseh shehazman grama, the Ashkenazi halacha is that the woman can still make the bracha, like lulav. The woman is dismissed. She doesn't have to be to do lulav. But when she does it, she make a bracha al netilat lulav. Sfaradim they don't make, because the woman is dismissed, so you cannot say a bracha. Also, in the morning, kriyat shema. When a woman daven shachris, the kriyat shema, it's mitzvah that depend on time. Once the time is expired, the mitzvah is gone. Since it's to a limited time, everything that is limited to a certain time, a woman is dismissed. So, in kriyat shema, morning and evening, it's mitzvah taseh shehazman grama. The time caused the mitzvah. So you dismiss. You want a daven, no problem. You can say shema, but how you make the brachot of the shema? Baruch atah Hashem, yotzer ha-meorot, all these brachot, it's Chazal put it together to the shema. Since you dismiss with the shema, so in the Sfaradi sidurim for the girls, it doesn't say the name of Hashem. It says baruch, doesn't say baruch atah Hashem. It just says baruch yotzer ha-meorot. Skip the name of Hashem. Well, everyone goes according to what's the excuse of the Ashkenazim. They say, after all, it's praising Hashem. It's not brachot ha-mitzvot only. We're not making the bracha on the mitzvah only. It's a general praise to Hashem. We're praising Hashem. Yes, Hashem did not order me to do this mitzvah, but I'm a part of the nation of Israel, and we're praising Him. One way or the other, everyone does according to her custom. But, like I say, there's an opportunity for a woman to accept on her to do things that she didn't do until now. First, what she's obligated. More Shabbos, more modesty, more kosher, more Lashon Hara, all these things to improve. And then it's helping a lot in Yom Adin, because when the Satan comes and says, you see this Miriam, look what she did this year. 20% mitzvot, 80% averos. So she's guilty in Adin. But then she accepted on herself some more important thing. So come the Sanegor, the defense, and it comes an objection, excuse me, it's true, it's 80-20, but look, the future looks bright. And even in a secular court it works like this. If they come to the judge and say, yes, this is a criminal, but look, he already became Baal Tshuva, he went to yeshiva, he's stopped with the drugs, he's learning, look at the rabbis, what they say about him. Of course the judge take it to consideration. That's what we really wanted. We wanted to cure this person, not to be a threat to society. So what if 50% there? It takes it to consideration. Letters. Many times I'm asked to write letters for Jews who are about to go to jail. Recommendation letter. And the judge, in the last minute, let's say he sentenced them to 7 years, once he received the letters, he lowered it to 5.5 years. It takes months away. Those letters are taken to consideration from this rabbi, from this organization, from charitable account that he was giving. They take it. They check everything and they give a discount. So if in a world of lies it's like this, in the world of the truth it's needless to say. So it's enough that a woman comes and says, you know, I'm accepting on myself to stop with this, to do this better, to give more tzedakah, to convince my husband, to push my husband for more Torah, for less materialism. I'll tell my husband, learn an extra hour a day. No, no, it's too much for me. No, no, we make less money, I'm more than happy. Cut from this, cut from that, I don't want that, I don't want any more this jewelry and that jewelry, I'm okay, I'm giving it up. For me, it's more important, you go to learn Torah. One woman asked me about 2 weeks ago, when I got married, my husband promised me, I told him, I'm only getting married to you if you learn every day, morning and evening, and she made a set of rules for him. In the first few weeks, he kept his word, and then stopped. He stopped going to Minyan, he's not learning, and I don't have to tell you what's happening. So she asked me, what can I do? I tried everything. I told her, make a scandal in the house. Mamash, a real scandal. His life will be impossible with you. Show him that you really care about the Torah like you make scandals when he take away your allowance or something that it's the most, or your cleaning lady. Imagine a woman when her husband comes and says, I'm sorry, dear, no more cleaning lady. You have to clean the bathrooms on your own. A nightmare of every woman. What would happen? What? Yes, she cries, she go crazy. I'm not going to let it happen. Talk to your parents. I don't care. Go to the Gemach. It's your problem. Find another job. She'll never give up. But when he comes and say to her, listen, you know, I'm learning 3 hours, but it's making me tired. It's enough. I'll learn an hour and a half from now on. Well, are you sure? Yes. Sure. I don't think it's a good idea. Yeah, yeah, listen, I got to make more money. We have to marry our children soon. Give them enough excuse. Okay, that's what you want. 2 minutes, she gives up. Cleaning lady, 1 month scandal. She runs away with the baby to her mother. He has to convince her, okay, come, Sylvia, come back. But Torah, 2.5 minutes, she's okay with that. Why? It has to be the other way around. And a woman thinks, it's not my problem, it's his problem. I have my own problems. No, no, no. Ishto ke gufo, you have to push him. It's your responsibility to push him, to get up earlier in the morning, to wake him up in the morning. Shabbos minyan, 9:45, beginning brachos. What is this? Busha v'cherpa. The day is almost over. 9:30, Kriyat Shema is over already 45 minutes ago. He's already, he ate so much last night, he cannot move. A kosher woman, 7 o'clock already, what are you doing in the house? Get up, do something, read Tehillim, go, mikveh, go to the shul, go to a kosher minyan. What is this, 9:45 waiting for a minyan. It's not the right way. Either do it in the right way, or I don't want to say what. Do it in the right way, and it's your responsibility. You know, women knows that if they really want, whatever they want, the husband will do. If they really want. However, some of the things they don't care so much. So if there is an argument, they give up because they really don't care. But the things that they care, it's a World War III. Now, it's either my way or the highway. That's it. They're not giving up. Now tell me if you disagree with one thing I say so far. Don't be embarrassed. One thing I say, it's incorrect. I exaggerated. I'm dreaming. I'm hallucinating. You don't know what I'm talking about, say, don't be embarrassed. Let's hear. You're all smiling. What's this smile means? That I'm hallucinating or you're agreeing with me? Huh?
We agree.
Agreed? Everyone? Thank you for saving me. Okay, one more thing. I'll tell you a story about the Chafetz Chaim and then I'll give you some time for questions. You know, the Chafetz Chaim, there's a very interesting story. Some of you know the family Zaks, which is grandchildren of the Chafetz Chaim, but not that many people know the entire story. The story is that when Chafetz Chaim was a little kid, his mother, she had to get married to another man. So he had a stepfather. And the stepfather, his mother and the stepfather, they had kids from first marriage. So it was the Chafetz Chaim from his mother. And the father had a daughter 10 years older than the Chafetz Chaim. 10 years older. And the husband of the mother of the Chafetz Chaim, we are talking more than 100 years ago, started to put pressure on his new wife, she wasn't new anymore, that if she won't force her son to marry his daughter, he'll divorce her. So he was actually putting pressure So one time he heard their conversation, that the wife, he saw his mother very upset. How am I going to tell my son to marry a 10 years older girl than him? So he heard that. So he came to his mother and said, no problem, for Shalom Bayit, I'm willing to do it. And he agreed to do it. And what happened is that after he got married, you know, so he got married to her. And from this shidduch, all the Rabbi Zaks, the first Rabbi Zaks, all of them came from that family. The entire, all the keep mitzvot. But from the first zivug, almost nobody stayed. They don't know where they are. Only after giving up so much, maybe I don't remember all the details of the story, but just to get the idea, that in the end of that story, is Hashem is showing us a sign that he was giving mamash his life to save his mother from this situation. And from that second zivug, what happened is, his wife passed away, and he had to get remarried, and they forced him to marry a woman that is 10 years older than him. But from the first shidduch, almost none of his children are survived. No one knows they are. They became secular. They died in a war. They're all gone. But from the second shidduch, that he married this girl that's 10 years older than him, he had all this, they married, his daughters married the Zaks. Rabbi Zaks was a big Talmid Chacham. And all the Zaks families that you have today, it's third generation from there, which they all Shomrei Mitzvot, and they, you know, in the Olam HaTorah, and this and that. So the whole point is same thing Bet HaLevi. Bet HaLevi married a woman with 8 children. After his wife passed away, he agreed to marry a widow with 8 children. And he had more kids with her, and all the Soloveitchik famous family came from the second Zivug. Well, you see, when a person is sacrificing, Hashem helps a lot more. I'll tell you another story. This story you never heard in your life before. And I know it's hard to believe, but if you came just for that, it was worth it. Many years ago, Rav Reuven Elbaz is the pioneer of the Kiruv world. First one who started to do Kiruv in Israel is him. He has Yeshiva Or HaChaim in Yerushalayim, 8 floors. And he went to be Mesader Kiddushin in a wedding, and the Chassan did not show up. The bride standing in the chupa reading Tehillim, they were waiting for the Chatan. 8:30, is not showing up. Supposed to be there 6:30. And those days there was rotary phone, that's it. No cell phone, nothing. So I try to call his house, no answer. No answer, no answer, no answer. 300 people waiting and he's not showing up. Then one of the guys from his yeshiva say, well, some once in a while he goes to his grandmother. Maybe he's over there. You know the number? Yeah, I have it written down. He took his phone book. He has the number. They call up the place. The Chassan picked up. There's no caller ID yet. He didn't expect them to call him. No one knows I'm here. He picked up the phone. Rav Elbaz said, what are you doing there? We're waiting here for you already 2 hours. So Rabbi, I'm very sorry. I'm not showing up tonight. I'm not coming. He said, why are you not coming? He said, I had hesitation about this girl, to marry her, not to marry her. I decided I can't marry her. So now you decided? You couldn't decide that 2-3 months ago? Now you decided, a night of a wedding? I know I'm not right. I know everything, but I can't marry her. So the rabbi said, if you don't show up right now, I'll never leave you alone. Now, you cannot do whatever you want. It's not a joke here. There's a girl here waiting. You cannot spill her blood here. Rabbi, you don't have to threaten me. I'm on my way to the airport. I have a flight to the United States. I'm not ever coming back here again. From the embarrassment, I fly. I leave the country. And hang up the phone. That's it. Now he doesn't know what to do. What am I going to do? You know the stipler, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, lives a few blocks away. Ran quickly to his house. Comes inside, says, Rabbi, this is what happened. What am I going to do now? It's the biggest embarrassment. Mesader Kiddushin all these years, I never saw such thing. So the stipler told him, tell me, is anyone over there from the Bachurim in his yeshiva that looks a little bit like him? He said, maybe. He said, find a guy that looks like him and tell him that if he agree to marry the girl here tonight, I, giving him my guarantee that he will have the best marriage, the best children, the best shalom bayit ever. I guarantee. I put my name on it. He ran quickly to the place. He looked and said, you, come, you get married tonight. Come, true story. Come, you get married. What? He told him the story. He said, the stipler said, we have to save the dignity of this girl, the embarrassment. She's a great girl. Ma, nice, tzanua, everything, good family. What do you want? You want him to get married or no? He said, yeah, but you know, my parents with pajama at home. Call up your parents. Abba, come quickly, get dressed, wear a nice thing, I'm getting married. Much like a, looks like a comedy. So, waited 10 o'clock, the chuppah started. They got married. And then Rabbi Elbas, 10 years later, he said the story. He said, I've been following their kids for 10 years. Each one of them is the best in the whole yeshiva, each one. And I asked them from time to time, best marriage, best shalom bayit, best everything. Because we need siyata dishmaya. Where can you get more siyata dishmaya than this? Now you're laughing. It's not the only time it happened. It happened one time in Eretz Israel. They used to get married on Friday afternoon in a backyard in a neighborhood. Not like today, $500,000 Hilton hotel. Bring a chef from France. They used to get married. You know, the neighbors come. They all bring cakes, cookies, a little bit chickens, this, that. That's how the marriage was. In the backyard, in the neighborhood. That's how it was. Friday afternoon, a few hours before Shabbos, and then they go into the Shabbos meal. The meal of the wedding, because everyone was so poor, they couldn't afford now a meal and then another Shabbos meal. So the Shabbos meal became the wedding meal. People came, drank a little bit of l'chaim, and that's how it was. Not like today. You get married, sheva brachot, every night. Lakewood, Far Rockaway, Long Island, Muncie, Monroe, Lakewood. What is this? Ask Rav Chaim Kanievsky, they didn't have Sheva Brachot every night. They asked the Rebbetzin, Aleha Shalom, only 2-3 times they had, that's it. Not an obligation. If you already have a meal with 10 people, then you're required to do Sheva Brachot. You don't have an obligation to force a meal in order for you to have Sheva Brachot. Today it's Yarek Velo Yavor. 3,000, 2,000, 1,500, everyone, clothing. Now it becomes a nightmare. So wow, I just got married. It's like an army now. Running from one place to the other. No privacy, no nothing. That's why people looking for parties. Parties. If a person will go to every party is invited, they'll never learn Torah. Sometimes I ask someone in my lectures in Queens, where were you last week? I'm sorry, I had to go to a birthday party. Birthday party. Of who? A friend of a friend of his wife. What does it have to do with you? You have a shiur. One person, one Ashkenazi rabbi in Bnei Brak, he has a shiur every night from 8 to 9. Every night. He said to his group, tomorrow I'm not showing up. My daughter gets married, and I did not invite any one of you because I don't want you to cancel the shiur. Well, a wedding is not enough to cancel Shiur Torah. So you continue, you do Chazara for everything we learn, and Bezrat Hashem, the following day I come already. What Sheva Brachot? I come to the Shiur. Okay. So the next day, they all sit Chivrutot, five groups, you know, two and two and two, five. All of a sudden, he showed up. Didn't you say your daughter get married today? See, they dress nice. No wedding, what happened? So no, the wedding is a few blocks away here in Bnei Brak. I saw the rabbi is not showing up until he comes, until they do the ketubah, until the chuppah, until the brachos. I can squeeze an hour. Why to give up the shiur? At the night of his daughter's wedding, he ran quickly, he did the shiur, 9 o'clock he ran to the chuppah, and the chuppah started. This is a person who loves Hashem. He doesn't care about himself. He loves the Torah. This is what David HaMelech wrote. Tov li Torat picha me'alfei zahav v'chesef. Tov li Torah, your Torah, it's better than all I have. The palace, the horses, the servants, the women, the money, the gold, the fame, the glory, whatever I have, it's worthless for me. I wish I can be a yeshiva bachur. It's in Tehilim, you probably read it a few times. What is it? Shivti bevet Hashem kol yemei chayai. I wish. My dream is to be Shiva Bachu. Imagine now Bill Gates come, they interview Bill Gates. Bill Gates, the Jew, whoever he is. And they say to him, what is your dream for the next... My dream is to become Yeshiva Bachur in Yeshiva Or Israel, to sleep in a dorm, you know, to learn Gemara all day. Say, what, you normal? You have all this empire, you want to be Yeshiva Bachur? There was David HaMelech, it's in Tehillim. It's a part of the Tanakh. Part of the Tanakh. Because in those days, people knew what's the right way. And we sometimes understand, sometimes we don't. Bezrat Hashem, we have 1 week before Rosh Hashanah. Don't forget to ask mechila, one from another. If you owe money to people, pay it, even if it's goyim. If you can't afford to pay it, at least call them and make a settlement or a reduced amount or installments. Make some kind of a plan that this person won't be angry at you in the moment of Rosh Hashanah. Because if you go to Rosh Hashanah and there's few people you owe them money and they upset at you, it's very bad. Do something. Call, at least apologize. Give something, 5%, 10%, 2% from what you owe. Do something. And Bezrat Hashem, it's important. Ben Adam Lechavero, Yom Kippurim is not Mechaper. Between you and Hashem, you can do tshuva. You cannot do tshuva between you and Hashem for things that you had with other people. Fights, argument, your sister-in-law, your mother-in-law, your this, your that, the rabbi, the teacher, everyone with his problems, you gotta clarify it. And even if you're right, it's better you apologize. You get a greater reward. When you apologize when you are guilty, you have a reward. When you are not guilty and you apologize, your reward is 100 times better. It's a much better bargain. Don't only apologize when you're guilty. It's better to apologize when you're not guilty, you get a lot more. And then the person that he's guilty will feel a lot worse and it will make him also do tshuva. So you're gonna get also for him also. And next time if you see a person who doesn't like you or speak against you or hurt you, run and shake his hand, her hand. Run to her, how are you? You see how they cannot look at you, they're dying. That's the best punishment for them. But they talk against you all day, and you come, oh, how are you? Good to see you. Good Yom Tov. Good Shana Tova. That's the best cure. Believe me, after that, they won't talk against you. You made peace. Hashem give you the reward. Shana Tova, everyone. Thank you very much for coming. If you have questions, you can ask.
Thank you. Excellency, I recently have discovered you on tour anytime. I was on tour anytime and I was looking at different shirim, or Wallerstein or Shikwan, and I started listening to a lot of shirim, and I found you very interesting and very, you know, I don't live here, I'm from Brooklyn.
Ah, really?
My sister lives here, so I was for Shabbos. I said, normally I go once a Shabbos. She said, Rabbi Mizrahi is coming. I said, I'm going to stay all Sunday because I have to hear Mizrahi in person.
Interesting. So, I'm going to be in Brooklyn on Wednesday, actually.
I've been to your website, Anthony
Ryan. Very good. Thank you for saying
the debate with the Christian. Yeah. You know, I believe 100% that I don't need the cure, whatever. Right. I found it very interesting.
Very good.
So, thank you very much.
Impressing. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Shana Tova, call to.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have one question for you. Regarding sympathy.
Yes.
What is a woman's tefillah? I know
if
I'm asking
the
question.
What is the Simchat Yom Tov for a woman?
Exactly.
Her husband has to buy her something nice.
We're saying the work comes threefold. You're home all day. At least you don't have a minute for yourself. You know, you're busy. Like, comes all sorts. What are you doing? Like, if you work, like if a man would be working, would he be looking forward to his work?
Well, first of all, you're right. With all the serving and this, if you don't have help, if there's no older daughter, if there's no cleaning lady, then you become a servant of the Yom Tov.
Right. So
but really, the truth is that to serve people on Yom Tov and make everyone happy should have already be a simcha for you, that you are busy with such a mitzvah. But it's already a mitzvah. It should be a happiness.
Right. What I'm saying is, what makes you look forward? Yom Tov is coming. I'm going to be serving and cleaning up and 20,000 more
one thing. Thank you very much.
And who knows what else? What is there? You know, what to look forward to? I can't wait. Look when Pesach comes. Yeah?
Right. First of all, Pesach, I tell you why people exaggerate. The amount of cleanings that they do is way more than what's required.
I'm even in the end, everything has to be cooked. Not like when you can't even get up and go buy something for the
family. Right. Well, those who can afford, if they can buy, why not? Anything a husband can do to make his wife's life easier, he should.
Right. So, what generally, what is like the Torah? What is the way for? Is it only spiritually? There's no gashmias.
No, no. What? The Yom Tov is only working? Well, I've seen, I mean, my wife, she works, she serves, she cleans and everything, but she has hours to see, to talk, friends, guests.
Not when you have little kids.
Well, it's on and off. It's hour yes, 2 hours no, 3 hours yes, 3 hours no. It's on and off. It's not working 48 hours in the kitchen nonstop.
It is, I mean...
It feels like it sometimes.
Right? If he can get help, so I tell you what, today it's not so expensive. He can bring some Goya to come, even for a few hours. She comes with, she comes and helps. She cleans.
You're busy with, I mean, either with the kids, either.
But when you have guests, the women don't help. Like usually, when another couple come or something, the women.
Surprise! Not always.
Not always.
We have guests a lot.
Now you understand why we make a bracha baruch shelo asani isha. It's too much to do. Well, imagine you have to sit and learn Gemara 10 hours a day and break your head. It's also hard.
Yeah, as I was saying, it's sometimes...
Life is not a picnic. It says, Adam la'amal yulad. A person was born to hard efforts. That's the purpose of life, to work hard. So it's not only a man. It's a Adam means a woman also. Adam la'amal yulad. Man has the amal of Torah and work out of the house. And a woman is the children, is the cleaning, is the cooking, is whatever it is.
Right, so it comes in. You have to be with Sinuchi after. But generally, your work is 3 times as much as you would have in a regular day. The kids go to school, you can read, you can do it.
Yeah, but the man can say the same thing. Well, you have davening, Rosh Hashanah, 7 hours shachrit, and then mincha, another hour, and then mairiv, another hour, and Yom Kippur, and this, and then sukkah, and build the sukkah, and lulav, and looking. There's a lot of work.
The men still get off. They're not working. A woman doesn't get off. No,
just think,
okay, hey, kids go.
No, she does get off. She does. It's not all the time.
The
kids go to school. You have a few hours for yourself.
No, that's exactly what I'm trying to say. On the answer, when you're supposed, like, the men, yes, they have time to learn. They don't have to go to the
work. But let me ask you a question. Let's say the meal is over, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. You clean, you put everything back. 2 o'clock. You have until 7. What do you do? 5 hours.
We're warming up again.
The kids? What? The kids?
The kids, the babies. First, you have to cleaning up, washing with the dishes, and getting the food ready for the next one. In between, you have little kids. One of them is upstairs, one of them is fighting, one of this, one is that.
The husband should help in a case. If there's no other help, no kids who help, no cleaning lady,
help, saying,
no guests that help, the husband should help.
But if you go after, like, when the sickness is finally over, the woman go, okay.